Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Christine Gerbasi. I'm Vice President with Keenan's Property and Casualty Practice, and I'll be your moderator today. Your phones have been muted to minimize any background noise. Our webinar is planned to run about 50 minutes. It is being recorded. We will hope to have about 10 minutes at the end to take any questions, but questions are encouraged throughout the webinar by using the chat feature on the right-hand side of the computer screen. We'll leave a few minutes at the end to try to answer as many questions as time permits. On behalf of Keenan, Casbell, and Safer, I'd like to welcome you to our webinar, Active Shooter Basics, Life-Saving Concepts. We are co-sponsoring this webinar with CASBO, which is a nonprofit statewide association dedicated to promoting safety for California's public education community. Our other co-sponsor is SAFER. SAFER is a nonprofit, member-owned and operated California Joint Power Authority. SAFER provides excess property and liability coverage. It serves about 490 public school districts and community colleges in California, and it represents about 2.5 million students. Keenan's very proud to be associated with these two organizations, both who are very dedicated to providing resources to schools to help strengthen emergency preparedness efforts and ultimately help protect the safety of our students. It's with great pleasure I introduce today's speaker, Chris Dorn. Chris is a principal with Safe Haven International, which is the world's leading international nonprofit campus safety center. Chris, along with Michael Dorn, has authored many of the Keenan Safe Schools Safe College courses, including Crisis Response and Recovery, Emergency Operation Planning, Family Reunification, Tactical Site Surveys, and Visual Weapon Screening. Chris's area of expertise includes safety and emergency preparedness in schools, student drug abuse, weapons concealment and detection, school terrorism, as well as the production of training tools that help staff prepare and deal with the stress of these actual crises. Chris is a certified post-certified guest instructor at the Georgia Public Safety Training Center. Before I turn it over to Chris, I'd like to also acknowledge and thank our partners at Scenario Learning and Keenan Safe Schools Safe Colleges, whose partnership with Chris and Safe Haven International helped facilitate this webinar. Chris, I'll turn it over to you.
Thanks. Good afternoon, everyone, and thanks for joining in. We're going to cover a lot of ground today. I'm going to be moving pretty quickly, but a lot of the concepts that we'll be sharing are pretty basic and should make sense as I go through them. I'll just be using different examples to kind of come back to some key points. And the first thing I do want to mention is that while the course is titled Active Shooter Basics, there will be a lot of content in here basically to show that there are other things we need to worry about. In addition to active shooter incidents, there's a lot of focus right now on Sandy Hook, of course, and some of these similar incidents, but we find that, according to the research, school is still a very safe place to be. And depending on the year, the average school will experience a violent death about once every 6,000 or 7,000 years. That's not a Columbine or a Sandy Hook situation, but even a fight that turns into a student death or an accidental death with a weapon are included, as well as off-campus events related to the school, traveling to and from school. And so the real risk we see are some of the everyday incidents that can turn violent and can turn deadly when we overlook them, especially when we're focused so much on the big, scary stuff. So I'm going to show you today how we can prepare for everything while also still addressing some of the concerns that are really prevalent in everyone's minds right now because of Sandy Hook. I'm going to start out with some quick bit of information to show where I'm speaking from when I talk about some of the scenario concepts and some of the emergency planning and response concepts throughout the presentation. And basically, I'm going to be speaking a lot based on the evaluations we do with school districts across the country. We perform a lot of school site assessments where we look at the physical building and look for hazards and safety issues and things like that. But we also provide a lot of plan evaluation and overall evaluation of a district's level of preparedness. And through that, we've done a number of interviews over the past several years with staff members where we simulate crisis situations. We'll put someone in a small level of crisis stress by showing them either a video simulation of a crisis or a text-based version of a crisis, and they'll have 30 seconds to respond and tell us what they would do. And this to simulate the short amount of time you have to respond to some types of situations and the level of crisis stress that often prevents people from making some of the decisions and taking some of the actions they need to take. And with these assessments, we've done them in a number of different types of schools and a wide range of locations across the country. These numbers are now a little bit outdated because the past several months we've been doing assessment projects nonstop. But basically, we've done these assessment interviews in dozens of school districts across the country, more than 18 states. And many of these districts that we're doing these evaluations have experienced, have had quite a bit of government funding, training programs, assistance programs, purchasing of equipment, staff development sessions and whatnot, as well as many of them have experienced situations of their own with school shootings, stabbings, other types of deaths. So a lot of these districts are very experienced with these types of incidents. And we did over 2,800 scenario simulations with over 900 interviewees. At that point, the number is well over 1,000 people around the country. And when we talk to people in the school, we try to talk to different people at different levels of experience. So in a district, we'll try to get a range of people ranging from anyone like a student teacher, substitute teacher, custodians, all the way up to crisis team members and administrators. And the findings were pretty surprising. The average school staff member, including administrators, including line-level staff, will miss an average of one life-saving action step per scenario. And to tell you what we mean by life-saving action steps, that could be something like pulling the fire alarm during a fire to alert the rest of the school to evacuate. That could be something like calling a lockdown when you see a gunman outside the school, letting the school know that there's a tornado, in addition to taking sheltering procedures for yourself and your class. So while staff members would give some good responses to some scenarios, on average, people would forget key action steps. They would respond. And to give you some examples, a lot of staff members, when faced with a simulation of a fire in their personal workspace, would respond that they would evacuate their class and call the front office on their cell phone to tell them about the fire. Or they would call central office to get advice on what they should do. They would do just about anything but pull the fire alarm. About 90% of staff would either forget to or refuse to pull the fire alarm when faced with a fire because they don't feel like they're given that kind of authority, and they don't think about it because of the way they're trained and drilled. And I'll get into a little bit later how we can change that kind of reaction, because we see the same issue with situations involving weapons, of all types of weapons, and other dangerous situations that we see happen pretty frequently in schools. And then one of the key findings that we found is that the more schools do focus on active shooter training and drills specifically, the worse they will do at other types of incidents, including weapons incidents, medical incidents, natural disasters, severe weather, as well as the very incidents they're focusing on, which is active shooter incidents. After Columbine, there was a big push for people to do Columbine-style drills and reenactments and things like that. But the more people focus on one type of incident that has already happened, that will likely not happen in the same way again, the worse we put everything in general. And there are certain types of planning concepts and certain types of things that people do during drills that have a particularly high fail rate. And so we'll talk today about how we can adapt our drills and how we can react to some of these different staff behaviors and the decisions they make during a crisis. We'll talk today about how people don't behave as they normally should, how people just do bizarre things during crisis events. We can look at 9/11 or fires that take place in public places, any types of crisis events, and see that people do really bizarre things during emergencies. People sometimes will lose sight or lose vision or hearing for a period of time. They will lose memory. They will just fail to do the simple things that we would expect them to do, like pulling the fire alarm or taking protective actions for themselves and others. So we're going to talk today about how to address these gaps in a couple of different ways. First, we're going to talk very briefly about assessment-based safety and how we you know, want to look at the overall situation of a school and a school organization, a district, what have you, rather than focusing on what's in the media or what we think is the biggest concern. We often find other things that are in the background that are really more pressing issues. Next, we'll talk about pattern matching and recognition, which is a way that we can train our staff members to use the training that we give them, use the tools that they have available to be more effective in their use and be more effective in preventing safety incidents and responding to them when they occur. And then we'll talk about how we can give staff members permission to live, which is a way of training staff members to be able to use personal judgment and take action when actions should be taken to protect themselves and others. And we have a couple of poll questions today to allow a little bit of interaction here. And I want to do the first poll question, if you guys on the tech end are ready. And basically, I want to get a feel of the types of attendees we have here today. So if you could just check off if you're a school staff member, an administrator at a building, if you're an administrator at district level. And we also have some people from outside agencies here today as well. Okay, I think that's enough time to get some responses in. And if you haven't had time to get your responses in, I apologize, but we'll keep moving. Okay. So now we're going to move into the first section and look at assessment-based safety and how we can look at the actual level of risk in a school environment. So first, we're going to talk about how we assess the situation rather than guessing. And I'll give you a brief historical overview as well of the types of school violence we see, some of the active shooter incidents that we've had in the past, as well as some of the mass casualty events that we've had throughout our nation's history, as well as some other countries. And then we'll also talk about some of the common things that we see in schools, some of the common gaps that we see when we look at a school environment and schools' safety conditions. So first, I want to move on actually to the next poll question, and I'll give you attendees about 15 to 20 seconds to respond. What do you think the weapon used was in the most lethal school attack in the United States? So you can choose between knife, gun, arson, or bomb. And as the time is just about wrapping up, we're going to talk today about some of the different types of crisis events that have happened, and some of the more well-known as well as some of the lesser-known crisis situations. So the most lethal incident of school violence to date in the U.S. at a K-12 school was actually an arson fire at a Catholic school in 1958. And so the responses show that about 42% of you thought it would be a gun, and next was knife, arson was third, bomb was fourth, from the people that responded to the poll. And that's about typical what we see when we poll parents, students, educators around the country. And what's most popular in the media is things like Columbine and Sandy Hook, but actually the worst incident, as I mentioned, is the one here on the screen now, which was a situation where we can learn a lot from this one case study of looking at a school, because there were three key areas where there were failures that allowed the death number to be so high. The first was that there was a large number of unlocked, unsupervised space in the school. So a student was able to get out of class on a hall pass and get into the school's boiler room, which was unlocked. And as I'm telling the story, think in your school about the places you might have or your schools where there are unlocked spaces that students could get into. Commonly, when we do our school inspections, we find faculty lounges, mechanical rooms, custodial closets, boiler rooms, roof access, crawl space access. These are the kind of areas that we do find unlocked. And the student was able to get into an area like this, started an arson fire, and he went back to class. So the next thing that went wrong in this situation was that there were a number of fire code issues going on in the building. Small fire code violations within the building construction as well as the building practices. where the fire was allowed to spread more quickly than it normally would. So the fire spread throughout the building, and the next thing that happened was that staff reacted exactly as they were conditioned to react. The school had regular fire drills where staff members would evacuate the building in a very short amount of time. They were very orderly, knew what to do. But when the actual fire happened, the teachers conferred in the hallway. They had the students wait and pray the rosary because it was a Catholic school. And the teachers conferred and decided that they had to wait for the bell to be rung by the school headmaster, because that's what they always were used to hearing during drills before they would evacuate. So they waited, and the headmaster was actually out of the building across campus at the time, so there was a number of minutes that elapsed before the bell was actually pulled. And so as a result, 95 people died in that fire, and a number of other people were disfigured and burned for their entire lives because of this situation. So we saw, first of all, that there were problems with areas where students could get into they shouldn't be. Second were minor fire code violations, and third was that the staff had been conditioned to wait for that bell. And so even though we all know that if there's a fire, we should get out, and we all know that this is how we should react, these teachers, who are just as intelligent as any of us, who care just as much about kids as any of us, decided to wait for further instructions because this is what they had been conditioned to do. And we've seen this in school crisis events, active shooter events, all across the country and around the world, where people will kind of freeze and panic and wait for instruction because that's what they've been conditioned to wait for. So moving on to the second most lethal attack in the U.S. Was a bombing incident in 1927. So we're going pretty far back here with some of these incidents. And what we're showing is that it's not a new thing. It's not a modern phenomenon. There may be more frequency nowadays of some of the high-profile incidents, but these really large-scale, pretty disastrous events have happened for quite a while. This was a disgruntled school board member, former school board member, who was also a farmer, who dynamited his house, dynamited the school, and he actually had been planning his attack for a very long period of time. And a lot of people in town, when they heard about the attack, knew it must have been this one guy because he was well-known in town as being kind of an odd fellow. So there were a number of warning signs, but they just didn't think he would do something quite like this. So the next one is not an attack, but is the worst loss of school, loss of life in a K-12 school in the U.S. And this was an explosion due to a natural gas leak in Texas in the 1930s. And so this actually was the incident that caused the natural gas nowadays has the identifying odor that you can smell, so you can tell when there's a gas leak because of this incident, because the school was actually filled with gas and nobody could smell it, and it sparked off an explosion that killed well over 300 people, destroyed the entire building, and as you can imagine, was very disruptive to the community and everything about it. So as we talk through today, we want to focus on preparing for dangerous incidents, intruders, active shooters, things like that. But we also want to remember the basic stuff, the basic fire safety issues, the basic utility safety issues, and basic procedures that can really save a lot of lives. So now I'm going to give you a few incidents from around the world. One that's just a really interesting incident was a man who made his own homemade flamethrower in Germany and entered a classroom and burned, I believe the numbers were over 30 people that were injured in this incident. So that's a really kind of bizarre one. And next I've got just a quick few to run through of things that have happened in China. There have been lots more than this. You can find a list. I believe there's even a list on Wikipedia of all the school stabbing incidents in China. But there have been a number of incidents that are really with really high number of victims and interesting types of weapons. So this was a stabbing by a bus driver, an arson fire at a preschool that killed 3 people. And going back actually to that one, he used gasoline to ignite the fire. And one of the basic safety things that we find at schools during our assessments is unlocked, unsecured gasoline that's kept on the school property that could be used to burn down the building to attack people. This one, a man made his own firearms and took them to carry out an attack. So if they can't buy them, or steal them. They can make them on their own. And without any weapons at all, a man entered a school and threw several children out of a window, killing one of them. So there's some pretty horrific incidents around the world involving a number of different types of weapons. So it's bigger than an issue of gun control or an issue of American media or American society. It's really more of a common phenomenon that happens throughout history and throughout different cultures. And so now we're going to look again back at ourselves, back at our schools, and see the things that we commonly see in schools. Is this something that you've seen in one of your school buildings or looks familiar, where we're just storing it there because of this event going on, or we just don't have the storage space to put that here? And it may not be as blatant as this. It may be something more subtle. Small blocked exits in classrooms that are not commonly used, so their desks and tables are placed in front of them, which takes away a possible exit someone could use in an emergency. The basic safety things that we see in schools. So this is a fire code violation and relates mostly to that, but if you imagine an active shooter being in this open space here and people trying to get out this exit, then it could be very important that this exit's not blocked in such a way. Something like this that could take out a whole school. If there's a long weekend holiday over the summer and a teacher has something plugged in the classroom that has bad wiring, frayed wiring, damaged wiring over time, then you know something small like that could cause a pretty disastrous incident when a school has to relocate because of new construction, because of a fire that destroyed it. And some of the other common things that we see are blocked or propped fire exits. You can see here these doors that are supposed to close automatically on their own have been propped with these door props. And that's actually in this building, staff didn't realize that the doors had been fixed and didn't need to be propped to stay open any longer. Storage issues. In this storage closet, a staff member had stored items too high and actually bumped one of the utility lines running up through the closet and damaged part of the ceiling, which creates a number of code issues and safety violations. And this is just a small thing that might cause a lot of damage, depending on what runs through these lines, injury to persons, possibly even death, depending on the situation. We also look for positive things, because as much of the negative that we find, as much vandalism and things like that, we find that a very positive approach to the building body language, focusing on beautifying the school with murals, artwork, bright coloring, inviting designs, and things like that, that can do a lot, almost as much as some of the access control measures that we focus on, some of the higher cost issues. Because by tying students to the building, we really increase the sense of community and ownership, and we reduce the chances for vandalism and damage and other types of criminal activity. And it can really have a positive effect on the overall building culture, because there's a large connection between building culture and setting a positive tone and safety. Now, one of the most common gaps that we are seeing in schools, especially in the last few months, schools have been in a rush to install security vestibules and bulletproof glass and other target hardening features. And we've really left ourselves open and vulnerable in a few key areas. One is visitor sign-in procedures. If you have a visitor sign-in procedure that allows people to sign themselves in without much staff oversight, then you don't have a very effective program at keeping people out of the school that should not be there. The system in this photo is actually a computerized system that, depending on how it's used by the client district, this system will actually look up and scan sexual predator databases and things like that. And some of the systems are more advanced, where they scan driver's licenses and scan national registries, scan lists of people that are barred from campus specifically. But if they're not used correctly, then it's easy for someone to come up and type in a fake name. Typically, when we do these types of school visits, we'll sign in as something like Barack Obama or Chuck Norris or George Bush, Charles Manson. And we do that to test and see if staff notice. Unless staff members are checking photo ID of people they don't know, checking visitor badges. For example, if the system allows staff members to verify the person's identity on the pass before allowing them to enter the building, that would be a step better in access control. But as this system is set up, visitors enter the office, sign themselves in, and then can proceed into the school. And just to give you one example where this has played a role in a real incident. There was one non-custodial parent who came to the school to abduct his two children and take them across state lines. And when they looked later at the sign-out sheet, he had written reason for signing students out, payback, because there were custody issues between him and his ex-spouse. And as you can imagine, that doesn't look very good when the investigation is taking place or if there's litigation afterwards. So looking at how people sign in, what they sign in as, checking them against a list of sexual predators, a list of people barred from campus, a list of people with custody issues, that's one of the major gaps we see in the school. Another gap we see at the front entry area is that a school will often have their sign-in books and their visitor badges out where the average visitor can take them freely. So in this school, for example, I could take this whole roll of stickers and have free access to your school at any time because most staff are just going to look for that visitor badge and then assume the person has signed in. So if you allow people to access the badges at the front desk, or if you allow people to leave with their badges without returning them at the end of their visit, then it makes it much more vulnerable for people to come back at a later time and bypass your access control measures. Another place where we see gaps in access control, despite target hardening features, is prop doors on the rear and exterior of the building. So you can have as much barbed wire and bulletproof glass and sign-in procedures as you want at the front of the facility, but if you have rear doors that are propped open or have to be open for some other reason, then you have a much less secure perimeter. So there are some campuses, for example, many high schools with multiple buildings have to leave doors open for students to access back and forth between the buildings throughout the day. There are also a lot of schools with trailers or prefab classrooms outside the building, so there will be a single door or a set of doors that are open to go to those for student access, for bathroom use and whatnot. And there's a number of ways to address that, you know, barring new construction or renovation. One is that mobile classrooms, portable classrooms, can sometimes have a hall pass with a key designated for the students, so students have to use a key to get back into the building, and thus access and hall passes are limited and restricted in some ways. If you have a little bit more budget, with the same situation, you can have proximity card readers or a keypad at the door where students have a certain code they can use at certain times or certain cards they can check out to sign in or to get through the door, rather. And depending on the ID system you use, if you have a student ID system, a staff ID system, sometimes these proximity readers can be built into those cards, and that can be helpful for allowing people to pass from building to building while keeping the facility secure. But more importantly, if there's an incident where staff are outside the school and they need to get back inside the building quickly because of danger, for example, a gunman or an aggressive dog or severe weather, then they can use these proximity card access points to get back in the building more quickly. Because that's another one of the gaps that we see is that staff members do things like this. They'll prop doors or leave doors unlocked when they shouldn't because they need access to the building and they don't have easy access. We also want to make sure that we don't provide the means for people to attack us more easily. We can do as much as we want to keep weapons out of our schools, but when we provide them in a school, and this is fairly common to see in a school, this number of items. This is from one school where they had all these different items spread throughout a single room, which is a little extreme. But most schools in the U.S. that I go into, I can walk into one of the faculty lounges or work areas, teacher rooms, and any area with a kitchen, and commonly find these types of knives accessible to visitors. And that's another reason to keep those unlocked, unsupervised spaces secured, so that you might need some of these items. For example, the bug spray, some of the tools might have a legitimate use in the school, but you don't want to make it easy for someone to come in and make use of those as a weapon. The other thing that we see commonly are these unlocked, unsupervised spaces that are easily lockable from the inside. For example, many faculty restrooms are unlocked and would allow a student or a visitor to enter this area and lock themselves in to carry out some kind of illicit behavior, sexual activity, drug use, anything that needs some privacy where they can gain that privacy. So one of the solutions that's a cheap or low-cost solution is aftermarket locks. This is an example of what one district has on their faculty lounge, so that rather than frustrating staff members and saying you've got to use a key every time you want to go into the restroom or the faculty lounge, you can make it easier by using proximity readers or keypad access like this. And this is a very cheap option that can be installed in older doors. One of the other common concerns we've been hearing from schools is about classrooms that can't be locked from the inside. So, for example, during a lockdown, if a teacher has to go into the hallway and put themselves into the line of fire, potentially, and then retreat into the room after locking the door, this is one way that you can keep a room unlocked and provide access throughout the day while keeping it locked. Ideally, we'd keep spaces locked in the building. For example, teachers teaching with the classrooms locked, most areas secured, and students well supervised throughout the building. There's sometimes when you might need to keep a door locked so that you can lock it quickly during a lockdown, but then also be able to freely access it throughout the day. And so this is one solution some schools have used. There are some vendor products out there to do the same thing, but this is basically a rubber band twisted around each door handle and then crossed in the middle, so it would depress the locking mechanism. And this would allow someone to, from within the room, quickly lock the door without opening it. Again, it's not a perfect solution, but that's one of the things that schools have been doing on their own. And there's a number of considerations with that. And the main one is that if you're going to use this procedure, you want to have your staff practice it and feel comfortable with it rather than just passing out a bunch of rubber bands and telling them how to do it or telling them this is the new way to secure their rooms. One of the other common gaps we see in the school facility that could allow vulnerability to any number of things, including active shooter events, but also the more common child abductions, custody issues, and things like that, is student supervision. This is an example of a class that was outside in the rear of a school. This area is accessible to the public, and it adjoins a public park. And at this point, you can see these kids are passing back into the building, and there's actually no staff member because she has just gone inside the doorway. And here's another picture from about a minute later when the teacher is probably at some distance down the hallway, and there's still about 5 to 10 kids outside that are just struggling. And at this point, it's much easier for these kids to bully each other, to steal, to fight, to trip and get injured, and not have a staff member around to help them, or for someone to attack these children or try to steal one of them. Another pretty big gap that we see in a lot of schools is roof access. So this is an example of a photo that we took during a weekend assessment. We basically saw this roof access where kids were on the roof on the weekend, and as they saw us arrive, they scrambled down the roof. This is actually a gas line on the side of the school they were climbing up. Gas lines, gutters, other things. These are vulnerabilities for this type of reason, for vandalism, for students getting injured while playing on the roof, but also because this is a key point where people can often access the building. If someone can get on the roof, they can sometimes get into the school, access security systems and other areas, which, you know, something could be exploited by someone trying to carry out some kind of violent attack. So moving on from the building-specific issues, we also want to look at what people feel about the school or the school community by looking at student surveys, staff surveys, and parent surveys. These can be done online, on paper. There's a number of different ways, and that's a whole another topic as far as how to do these. But basically, we want to look at student reporting of bullying, gang activity, drugs, weapons, violence, where they feel unsafe in the school, if there's anything specific that could be done to improve their level of safety. And we really can learn a lot from those, especially when we allow these anonymous surveys. And in talking to parents, we'll hear a different picture usually. But by looking at the staff, the student, and the parent surveys, we can usually draw a pretty good assessment of what the impression of the school is. And often these will be things that we are quite aware of to start with, but we'll usually learn some key things and ways to fix those. And then another thing we can combine those with is infinite data. So rather than just listening to rumors and talking about what are addressing areas that we know and frequently talk about, then we can look at areas where infinite data, police reports, discipline reports, reports from students about specific areas where they feel unsafe. One district used this by looking at the types of the incidents, the time, location, and then how easily they could predict these based on those factors. They were actually able to cut their incidents by over 50% they actually used GIS mapping for their schools and were able to map out key locations to send staff members to increase supervision or change supervision practices. And they were actually able to do quite a bit of improvement. And this photo is one of many examples we have showing types of areas that have chronic vandalism. So this is back when schools used to have payphones pretty commonly, and this is the area where all the students would hang out. And we can see that based on the wall and the damage to the equipment here. And this is an area where maintenance people at the school said that they spent a lot of time repairing this, fixing this, and refurbishing this area after it's been vandalized. And that misses the key point of this, which is that this is obviously an area where there's poor supervision, where students are able to do this kind of damage and feel like they can get away with it. So we want to look at things like this in our schools and look at the underlying factors that relate to them. And then again, looking at incident data, surveys, other information to create a picture that we could use so that rather than just buying metal detectors or putting in security policies or building safety plans, we're actually tailoring an overall response framework that we can use for the school itself. So for this first topic, we talked about assessing the building, looking at some of the things that we often see and say, well, we can't do anything about that. These are hazards that we inherit, but seeing those as the risks that they are. We talked some about the historical overview of incidents, types of incidents that are very common, and also some of the things that we commonly see in schools, some of the key gaps that should be addressed. So now we're going to talk about how we can allow staff to tie all this together, tie their training together and their tools. And so we want to talk about pattern matching and recognition. And this is basically allowing staff to use personal judgment to evaluate a situation and see if something doesn't seem right. This is a video clip from one of our scenario simulations. And this was basically a mother coming up to a school during recess, and she is grabbing a child and trying to leave with the child. And any staff member seeing this would be able to use their own judgment and evaluate the situation and see that something just doesn't seem right from looking at the woman's expression, the way she's acting, the way she's talking in the scenario. And so training staff to act on those kinds of judgment and act on those kinds of decisions rather than just assuming that it's not their job or it's not their role. And I've got some more dramatic examples of these onward. But first I want to talk about where this concept came from. The initial concept of pattern matching and recognition came from the medical field, where in cardiac units, typically nurses had limited power to address risks or other areas of concern, and it was up to doctors to provide a lot of the feedback and decision making on patient care and whatnot. So the nurses were traditionally given the task to watch the EKG for cardiac patients, and if they saw a certain pattern show up in the EKG, they would then be able to call in a crash cart and alert the team to be ready for another cardiac arrest or more severe health concerns for that particular patient. And what they did was they changed this policy. So not only were they supposed to watch the pattern, but they were allowed to also look for, to paraphrase, anything that the patient, any symptoms the patient exhibited that seemed different than what similar patients do in similar situations. So basically, to put it another way, anything that doesn't look right or doesn't seem right. So the equivalent for the school would be the secretary noticing a parent come in that she knows, and she knows how he normally acts, but today he has a little bit different demeanor or seems a little bit more upset, or the person walking funny because he's carrying a gun, or the person that has been complaining at the school over a period of time, and today you can tell today is his day to just really lose his temper at the school. Some of these key things that staff often miss, when we provide them a specific framework and the specific guidance to use that kind of judgment, can really maximize the power of the human mind, maximize the power of decision making in staff, and allow our staff to use those tools that we have provided them with the training. And it really increases connectivity between staff, students, and parents as well. And so keeping that in mind, the concept of pattern matching and recognition, I'm going to go through the next section, which is demonstrates how staff often respond to certain types of crisis situations and the types of reactions we see to different types of events that really shows how staff use those concepts of pattern matching. So we call this section permission to live because we find that we need to give staff members not only the tools and the training but the permission to live and the permission to use that training. Just like the fire example I gave from 1958, those staff members were conditioned to hear that bell and conditioned to react in such a way. So while it seems bizarre to us, they're behavior was almost predictable. And so we can look at the ways we do drills and do training to address that nowadays. So the first thing we want to look at is that there's a window of time. We call this the window of life. It's the first 30 seconds or so of a crisis that a staff member has to react. And this could be pulling the fire alarm if there's a fire before it's too late, calling a lockdown before the individual breaches the building, taking any kind of action that is needed to take immediately before it's too late or the situation goes out of control. And so allowing staff to make these kinds of decisions during drills can be very helpful in empowering them to act during a training and in writing. And using scenario-based training can really help to build a base of experience and build a base of knowledge to allow staff to mentally simulate what they're going to experience in a crisis. As staff see the images and videos that I'm going to show you in a second, you can see the gears start turning and they start thinking about the different types of things they could experience and do experience and how they would respond. Because in many situations, they haven't thought these through. And we find that the concepts that we're pulling these from come from the military, from airline pilot training, from police training, where these individuals are allowed to, as part of their training, experience a number of scenarios and situations. And then their brain, rather than having to function and work and make decisions, they actually just act. One of the firefighters interviewed for the research behind some of this knowledge stated that he doesn't make decisions. He's never made a decision in his entire career. He just acts. And so we see that where when people become really skilled in the field, they can make decisions based on quickly assessing it. And by allowing staff to practice these drills and practice scenario-based training, they're better able to quickly pull the correct response from their mental library when it happens. So we don't know who is going to be who will be the first person to see danger. If it's going to be the staff member outside with the class at recess, is it going to be a teacher in the classroom with a student having a seizure or a diabetic student with issues? Any kind of medical situation that could really turn deadly if it's not properly addressed, depending on the time and the situation. Students with EpiPens or asthma inhalers. Could be other life-threatening situations. So I'm going to talk very briefly about some of the reasons that we respond so differently during crisis. And that's basically as your heart rate increases, as your stress level increases, we start to lose some of our skills. We start to lose some of our basic motor skills. Then we start to lose more and more of our motor skills. And eventually we get to a point when we reach tunnel vision, we reach hypervigilance, and we stop focusing on the situation, but yet we're unable to act in certain ways. Some people lose sight, lose hearing. They do rote actions over and over. For example, in schools that require you to dial 9 to get out to an outside line, school staff will dial 911 over and over without realizing what's going on and why they can't get an outside line. And so even at 115 beats per minute, at a basic level of excitement, it might be hard to put a key in a lock, to lock a door in a hallway, for example, to get your keys out of your purse, to take basic life-saving actions. So we're going to go back to the fire in 1958 and do a quick poll, and I'll just give about 20 seconds to respond for this one. How many of you have actually pulled a fire alarm? And that's not the fire control panel or anything like that, but if you've had experience actually pulling the physical pull station. And we do this as we go and do training around the country and when we talk to staff. And generally we see fairly low numbers of people that have actually done this and a reluctance of line-level staff to pull fire alarms. And we can go and close off at the poll, and we'll see those results in a second. But one of the ways that you can change your drills to allow staff to make these decisions is by using staff-initiated drills. So allowing staff members to pull the fire alarm, for example, allowing staff members to call the lockdown, that might be an all call from their classroom, or in some buildings that might be them calling the front office and saying, we need a lockdown now, rather than saying, can I speak to the principal? There's a suspicious guy outside with a gun, and I'm not sure what we should do, et cetera, and letting that person make the decision versus allowing staff members to quickly make that decision. And the poll results show that about half of the people that responded have not pulled the fire alarm, and a much smaller number actually has, and that's very common. And so by allowing different staff members to pull the fire alarm during each fire drill, We test each fire pull station more frequently. We allow staff members to get that physical memory in their arm of pulling the pull station. We allow people to really experience that decision-making process. And that can be done with lockdowns, tornado drills, severe weather drills, earthquake drills. Any types of drills you might have can be done where you basically tell the staff member, we're having a drill today, you're the one that sees the fire. What do you do? Or you're the one that saw the gunman. One of the other types of drills that we can do to advance staff thinking and planning is blocked exit or blocked access fire drills. This is an example of a school in North Carolina that actually had the fire department come out with a fire smoke machine to set up this this drill. But some schools just use signs or poster board, and basically having staff react to some indication that an exit is blocked, they have to think and use their alternate routes. Because otherwise, we commonly see people that just go right through smoke or flames or whatnot, rather than going around. Making sure that if there's something you're supposed to take outside during a real crisis, you want to take that out with you. For example, medical kits, evacuation kits, information about the school, roll books, emergency communication. Do all staff members know how to use radios and how to use them clearly and audibly for other staff? Or are you going to have a crisis and find out that one staff member doesn't know where the microphone is on the radio or how loud they should talk or how to use the frequencies and whatnot? If staff members are outside, is there a way they can be quickly alerted to danger and vice versa? So if this teacher is out here and she sees the person with the gun or the tornado or the angry dog, how is she going to notify the school and how can she get back in quickly? And then have staff been given their role-specific action steps. Many schools have come a long way in developing emergency procedures and action steps, but they usually combine all the different roles as one. But there's very different steps that a faculty member would take versus an administrator versus an after-hours staff member, transportation. And so dividing those out into different role-specific charts can be helpful as well. And so now we'll run through quickly some of the different types of scenarios. These usually would be videos, and we present and train with staff members and show video clips of actual crisis situations, but I'm going to show you some of the stills that we use for these. This one is a scenario we share with text with staff members, and basically if you see a gunman outside the school, what would you do? And you have a small group of students near the front entrance of the school. The common answers we get, a lot of people do go inside the school and shelter themselves, but some teachers would approach the individual and try to get him to put the weapon down. Some people would run around the outside of the building rather than trying to enter the building. We see some really interesting responses to the threat of a person with a gun, which is very different from the person using a weapon versus a report of a weapon in a book bag like we have on the right versus a person that's got the weapon waving it around as staff members. These are all very different situations with weapons that are often lumped in under one weapons protocol. And so we encourage schools to have various types of weapons protocols for report of a weapon, use of a weapon, for hostage situations. In some situations, it might be better to retreat from the area or try to take the weapon from someone. But in something like this situation, if the staff member and students follow instructions and move quietly and calmly, then the odds are that they'll survive the situation if they've been properly trained and act accordingly. And then training with law enforcement can be really critical as well. Having them come in and look at your shelter areas, advise you on, you know, where the best place to lock down for this certain area is, the best ways to get in or out of the building for certain situations. Training your staff members at all levels. Often the ones that see things the most, the custodians and bus drivers, are left out of the loop. So training your staff, your bus drivers, on what to do when someone's threatening them with a weapon, what to do when they find a weapon. We've seen a lot of cases where staff members will find something like this on the bus seat and then take it, put it in their pocket, put it in their bag, put it somewhere else, and take it to a supervisor later, and basically deal with the situation inappropriately. So focusing on what to do when people are using weapons in various ways and situations, in different types of weapons. We often find that people are reluctant to call lockdown or take protective actions if the weapon is not a gun. So for example, in this situation, this angry visitor comes in and demands to see the principal. The secretary tries to defuse the situation, then we cut the clip and ask what the individual watching the clip would do. And one of the most common responses we see is someone will say, well, I would send her back to see the principal. Some people say they would try to take the knife from her or tackle her. And those can be very dangerous responses for a number of reasons. situations involving other types of weapons. Many people see this scenario with a hammer, and they don't think of it as a weapon, and when really it can be very dangerous, and a lot of staff have been injured. And then situations where people don't have weapons but are equally dangerous or violent, and making sure staff are trained to deal with these types of situations rather than letting them escalate into something much more serious. Handling medical emergencies and injuries and other things like that, accidents, they can also be dangerous. And then this one is a little bit different and less common, but we have seen lots of schools with issues with animals coming on campus. Recently, there was a case in Florida where an SRO actually was able to wrestle the alligator because of personal experience growing up on an alligator farm. We see a lot of campuses where dogs, large, aggressive, angry dogs, are kept very close to the campus. And then animals that might escape from the zoo. Depending on what area you live in, you might have your specific type of animal. And I have this picture here to show an example of not only what do you do when you're on campus and you have these different types of situations, weapons incidents, dangerous animals, custody issues, anything like that, but what about field trips? What if you're on a field trip and you see students in your class doing this, and then the next thing you see is the animal has attacked them and they've been injured? Or if you have a vehicle accident, a weapons incident, two kids getting into a fight, you want to make sure that all those things you have your staff prepared for on campus, they're prepared for off campus as well. And this is another example from one of our scenarios that I'm going to cut through time. But basically, we want to have staff trained to read situations and evaluate people rather than just reacting to do they have a weapon or not, or are they acting in this way or not, but really allowing people the tools to use that kind of judgment. So we want to focus on staff members making the right decisions very quickly and giving them the tools to do so, and focusing on the power that we have and our staff members have and our students and parents have, rather than focusing too much on technology. Technology can be great, but the human brain is incredibly powerful. And after going through all this negative doom and gloom information and focusing on the worst kind of stuff and talking about deaths and things, I want to remind everyone that it is a beautiful world out there. Like I said, the rate of violence in schools is actually decreasing, and it's still very safe to be in schools. And so we just want to remember to be clear and concise in our emergency instructions and our preparedness. And this is one of the interesting things we've seen in one of the schools we looked at. And then to close, I just want to remind everybody, I know that there's a lot of stuff to do and lots of things to worry about with safety, and there's always more and more and more that we have to put on our plate, but there are really important reasons for what we're doing, and I think we all know those. But I just want to remind everybody, you know, when all this seems like too much work and too much effort and too much to worry about, the world is a beautiful place, and there are a lot of reasons for us to keep doing what we're doing. I want to close at this point and open to questions. My contact information is in here as well. I'll be happy to respond to any later, but at this point we'll move to the questions section.
Thank you, Chris. We are actually just about out of time for today, so I think what we're going to do is if we get any questions submitted, what we'll do is we'll send out answers in a question and answer document along with the copy of the presentation and the recording, the link for the recording of this webinar. I did want to take just a minute to remind everybody on the call that we do have additional information available at Keenan Safe Schools and Keenan Safe Colleges. There's a lot of courses related to this topic, and there's additional information about school safety resources on PNC Bridge. We do have Chris's contact information, his email and web address if you want to contact him directly, or Safe Haven International. I've also included my email address and contact information in case you have any questions or need some help with the additional resources that we have available. So with that, I want to thank everybody for their time today. Chris, on behalf of Keenan, CASBO, SAFER, and California Public Agencies, we really appreciate you sharing this information today on a very important topic, and also the end reminder of the good things in life and why we're all putting this type of webinar on today. So thank you very much for that.
Thank you.
Thanks, everyone. And just to remind you that we will have a copy of the presentation on our website tomorrow. You'll all get an email when that is available so you can download the presentation as well as view the video online at a later date. And our next webinar is coming up on May 15th on the Affordable Care Act, so we encourage all of you to register for that if you're interested. Thanks very much for participating.